What?
What?
What show is that from?
Cut it out. I think that's from.
Was that? I knew exactly.
No,
it's Back to the Future. Back to the Future.
It was a TV show.
It wasn't Full House. It was before Full House. There was a show on Nickelodeon, and I can't remember what else. No, before Full House. Dave Coulier was on a different show. And he was a talk show host.
Bob Saget, right?
No,
oh,
it was
no, that's
before,
right. He did it before,
Full House, something like that.
When he was dating Alanis Morissette.
Today's episode is cool. It's about Cut It Out and Halloween and ghosts.
It's a really
great
Halloween episode.
Yeah, we had Jimmy
Penitent.
Now you can't say it.
Penitent.
You said it so well. Yeah, see?
The N gets me. Penitento. There we go. I always want to throw in an extra T. Penitento.
Otherwise,
why don't you say it, Jimmy?
Petanito.
Otherwise known as Mr. Haunted.
Mr. Haunted.
That's a good time.
Thank you.
That was fun. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah. So we're gonna here's the show. Ready?
Enjoy.
1, 2, 3, go.
Happy Halloween.
Okay.
Hello, boys and girls. Welcome to my Halloween house. It's time to go trick-or-treating, so be sure to light your pumpkins.
And hello.
Hi, Corey.
Cheshire Cast. Hi, I'm Corey.
And I'm Trisha.
And you are.
I am.
Trisha.
Hi.
The ghost. How you going?
Good.
You went missing.
Oh.
I put you on like milk cartons.
I
went around to stores and like stapled you onto milk cartons. And then I realized that was a bad idea. A lot of milk probably spilled.
The last 2 months of my life are like weird. It's been a weird two
Just
months.
Just the last 2 months?
Yes, specifically. Yes, weirder.
Okay.
It's about
weirder than
once you need medication to come out of the weird, it's weird.
Yeah,
thyroid.
But it was a health medication, not like a head medication. Health. You didn't have like a psychotic breakdown.
Right? I almost felt like I was having one. I swear, once your heart starts messing up, it really does feel psychological.
Yeah, but you're doing better.
I'm doing better. Better living through science. The medications are really working.
Awesome.
My brain is working again. It's fantastic.
Yeah, you look like you unintentionally maybe lost a couple pounds too.
20.
Wow.
Yeah. Actually, it's more like almost 25 now because it doesn't stop. It's
unbelievable.
Just stopping.
That's kind of nice.
You know, if that was the only symptom, everybody would want it. But
I'm like, look, you walked in here. You look like 8 years younger.
Right? I'm going to the doctors and they're like, you're losing weight. And I'm like, yeah, isn't that cool? They're like, not this quick. I was like, oh, but I'm walking. Like, I've been walking in the morning. I'm not eating bread. They're like, no, sorry. And that shake, that's not caffeine. I was like, oh.
But you're feeling better.
So much better.
And are you enjoying the fall?
I am. I actually have been out of the house like twice.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, there's like, everything's yellow. I missed the whole transition. It's just fall.
Everything's yellow.
All the leaves
colors
are yellow.
In my yard, there's multiple colors. Like I have some oranges and reds.
I have some, but we're driving. And
you're
I'm
all
like,
just yellow, huh?
The whole town. It's later fall than it feels like it should be.
Got
to
it.
Me.
I see.
I missed like 2 weeks of it.
Yeah, you did.
But right. I'm back.
I was trying to keep you informed with my one word responses and text.
That's better. I couldn't even text. My fingers, my thumbs were so shaky. It was so bad.
Well, I just feel like when somebody knows me well enough, if they send me a text message and I respond with one or two words, I feel like they know I've said a paragraph in those one or two words.
Why would that be? Two words are sometimes good enough.
Because sometimes I just don't want to respond.
It's when you respond with two words when it's required more. It's like, can you give me the directions to whatever? And you're like, it's a left then a right. Like, you need more then.
So we're in the part of the fall where I'm starting to probably irritate my neighbors a little bit.
Halloween's
coming. So I let my yard kind of go.
Oh, yeah. I saw the leaves.
I leave the leaves. I let the grass grow because I set up a whole graveyard in the front.
You're into Halloween. You are.
You know, so I do a whole graveyard. I get some ghosts. I get people coming by to dress up and scare people. So it keeps me from having to buy candy because nobody comes to the house.
Because you're frightening. My son was like traumatized last year.
You're right. He was.
He was.
There was two.
He'll say it too.
No, it wasn't last year. Was it last year with the?
Yeah.
But I wasn't the clown last year.
You weren't. OT was, and you were Mike Myers.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, he was a little scared.
Yeah.
He wouldn't cross the street. We left.
Well, yeah. So a lot of, you know, parents would come up and be like, be careful. But, you know, my love.
You also like stalk behind people. Like you're all into
it. I do the walk.
You do.
Yeah. So it's cool because my love of Halloween kind of segues into our guest. And I know I caught you, you know, mid sip, but.
You didn't need to point that out. Nobody would have known. And yes, I know how much you like Halloween. So as soon as I saw him on social media, I said, this is our Halloween episode.
Okay.
And he agreed.
So who's here?
So we have Mr. Haunted.
Hey.
Jimmy Pedanito.
I was going to say.
Thank you.
Did I do right? Pedanito?
Correct.
Pedanito.
Yeah.
See, you say it.
You're exactly correct. And, you know, something about the paragraphs when you text. Don't you hate when you say, how was your day? And you send this whole 3-paragraph letter.
Fine.
And they write a thumbs up.
It's just emojis now.
That's called a husband. That's just what happens.
Yeah, it is. How are you, sir?
I'm great. How are you?
Can't complain. I was kind of excited to have you in. I did some reading and some studying because I'm like, all right, who is this guy? You know, I had heard your name before. And I may be incorrect, but I'm fairly confident that you were present at Quinnipiac College when Ed and Lorraine Warren did a couple presentations.
Probably.
Back in the middle 90s.
The day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I used to go to all of them.
Explain who, like, Warren is. I don't know who that is.
Ed and Lorraine Warren?
Yeah.
Well, Jimmy, you do that.
All right. Ed and Lorraine Warren were one of the first paranormal investigators in the United States. There was also Hans Holzer was a big influence. And when I first started being interested in this, they were the only people that you knew of. It's not like now where there's you know, every channel has a paranormal show on. So it was really in its infancy, the paranormal investigation stuff. So Ed and Lorraine Warren, they founded their New England Society for Psychic Research in 1952. And I'm still part of that group.
1952.
Yeah.
People must have thought those two were insane. So,
well, what's really weird is when we used to come back from investigations, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning, we'd go to a diner and, you know, everybody would be whispering. Always they know who they are. They're kind of like making fun and stuff. And now they want their autograph.
You know, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Different now.
It's a celebrity.
Yeah.
No, they're both passed on, right?
Yeah. Lorraine just died earlier this year. And Ed in 2006.
Mr. Haunted. What do you do? What do you do?
I guess she wants to know what entails paranormal investigation. And
I saw the research I've done. You do a lot.
Yeah, I did a lot in the past.
Mm-hmm.
And
like what?
When my daughters were born, I took a little break.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah.
So you've been just hosting radio shows and writing books?
Yep. In the beginning, I you know, used to go almost every, like, 3 or 4 times a week to investigate homes or places. And I had 2 daughters, and while we were bringing them up, I was kind of like, you know, I kind of missed it. But also, we went to a lot of bad houses, and I didn't want a chance bringing anything back home. And also, I tried to be getting still stay involved. So I taught an adult ed class at the high school for 10 years.
Yeah, here in town?
Yeah.
Well, radio show.
Uh-huh.
Author. Exorcist.
No.
Not an exorcist.
I assisted in exorcisms.
Couple TV appearances.
So you're
a documentary film. Bunch of things.
So that's what you do. That's very cool. In the field of paranormal.
Correct.
All right.
So it's Halloween.
Yeah.
Tell us about some of this stuff.
Well,
like, When did you what made you get interested first?
All right, let's start when I was a kid. Let me lay back on the couch and
yeah,
psychiatrist couch. So when I was a kid, I was always a creepy little kid. Anyway,
what does that mean?
Let me tell you. I had a toy box that was very large.
Did you have a dragon that lived under the stairs?
I wish.
Walk around with a lantern.
My dad was a carpenter, so he made me this big toy box with big giant like handles that looked like a casket handles. And I would sleep in my toy box with my arms folded with a black cape on. You know, I thought I was a vampire. I'd keep cranberry juice in the refrigerator. That was my blood. I'd wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning. And yeah, it was creepy.
You were into it.
So I did not live in a haunted house, but let me go back to when I was a kid. Any TV show back then, there was a show called In Search of Loch Ness Monster, In Search of Bigfoot, In Search of Ghosts. And I couldn't get enough of that, but it wasn't on that often.
The macabre.
Yeah, and I needed to know all this information. I needed to know. So when I was about 10 years old, my mother had a friend over, and she goes, Jimmy, just
that's her?
Yeah. Jimmy.
She just visited us?
Yeah. She goes, stay up in your bedroom tonight. I have a friend over, and we're going to be in the kitchen, and, you know, just stay in your room. So...
My parents used to do that, but they're swingers.
Lies. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Mrs. Nash.
Come on. That was a well-played joke.
Perfectly timed. So I was a good little boy. I went upstairs, and these are the... And I remember it wasn't even dark. It was like 7 o'clock. It wasn't a creepy situation. Like, it was dark and scary or nothing. I was laying on my bed on my stomach, listening to a baseball game on the radio, and I was laying on my stomach with my feet bent in the air. My knees bent. And this was the old radios that they had two dials. One was for volume. One was for tuning.
I think that's the universal position that kids sat in the days before
like
they
Army
had.
Guys.
Yeah, before they had video games. Every kid laid on their belly with their feet kind of.
Like when you color, you have to have your tongue like this.
Yeah, the corner of your mouth.
It helps. It helps the coloring. So anyways, I'm listening to the baseball game. And all of a sudden, the radio started changing stations.
Mm-hmm.
And even as a kid, I said, oh, it must be some kind of interference or something, you know, something. But then I look over and I could see the dials going like this, back and forth. So I panicked. I remember my mother saying, Jimmy, stay up in your room. Don't go downstairs. Like, what do I do? And then something slammed my legs down on the bed really hard.
Ooh, it touched you?
It's just I didn't feel hands or anything, but
like
just like they got thrown on the bed really hard. So I ran down in my little Incredible Hulk pajamas. Mama, there's a ghost in my room, and I threw my legs down, and the radio's changing stations. She goes, Jimmy, get back up in your room. There's no such thing as ghosts. So,
and that started the whole
I think that
search.
Started. Hey, love, Ma, look at me now.
I wasn't wrong.
Yeah. So, like I said, I didn't live in a haunted house. It didn't have a lot of activity, but
if you didn't live in a haunted house, then what turned the radio? Was it because your mom's friend was downstairs, like, with a Ouija board?
I don't know. That's another thing. When I was 25, I thought I had all the answers to what everything is. And now I got older. It's like, I don't know. I know less.
Isn't it funny how that happens? Yeah. The older we get, the less we know.
And the less you care about how you know. Like when you're 25, you need to know everything. And now you're just like, I don't know.
When it happened, and I said, obviously it's a ghost. But you look back now, it's like, just because your radio moved, why is that a dead person that did it? Like, it could be so many different.
What else could it be? Honestly, what else could it be?
It could be some guy in Idaho changing his radio and somehow flipped. I don't know. It could be anything.
Sure. Well, there was that movie. What you're talking about makes me think of that movie. I think Dennis Quaid was in it.
Frequency.
And did you ever see this movie, Frequency? And they're talking to each other through time.
Something like that.
Because the ham radio signals get caught in the atmosphere. It's very...
Actually, we have some stories.
She'll like that.
Yeah.
Because that's essentially what the book is about, these communications that happen through
what book,
different...
Corey?
Oh, the book I'm holding, the book that I'm holding in my hand.
Right, Phantom here. Messages.
We really have to do a YouTube channel.
Jimmy Benenito.
And William J. Hall. Phantom Messages. Hall.
Available on Amazon.
So
Phantom Messages.
It's about oddball communications that come through a multitude of electronic frequencies and so forth, correct?
But some of them are predictions. What it's
well, the there was a book in the 1980s that was really popular called Phone Calls from the Dead. And I wanted to always write a book, but I wanted to write it on urban legends in New England or something like that. And my friend Bill Hall was an author already. He already wrote two books. So I was calling him to get suggestions on how I go about starting a book, because I wanted to do about my own experiences and urban legends, that kind of thing. So he says, well, I've been wanting to write a book too, and I just can't get a subject going, you know? So we just, within a half an hour, we said, hey, how about doing a revamping of the Phone Calls from the Dead?
Nice.
And see if we can get stuff with, now there's email and texts and...
it's a perfect book to read for Halloween.
Yeah.
It is. And the only thing I'm disappointed in is that I didn't read it before this interview. And
you really didn't have an opportunity.
Honestly,
just give it to them.
You have,
it's your show swag. You knew there was a book.
I knew there was a book, yeah. But I legit haven't had the opportunity. I've been trying to...
He keeps himself busy, this one.
Well, here we go. Sidetrack. I got a truck, and I've been working on building the truck, and I've been working on putting the trim in the back room.
Your windows?
Trimming the windows out in the back. I've been busy.
Political series?
Oh, we did the political series, and that was a lot of work.
That was a lot of work. I didn't realize you did episodes without me. I feel so guilty. I was so sick. I abandoned you.
You'll make it up to me.
Probably not, but I do feel bad.
You're making it up to me by being here.
Okay.
Because if you weren't here...
But I would have been here if I wasn't sick, though.
I know, but...
I'll take it. I'll take the credit.
But I'm glad you're not here. I'm glad you're here and not here.
Are you glad I didn't die? You're glad,
yes,
I didn't die.
That's what I was trying to get to.
Thank
is
you.
That Jimmy wasn't here, and then I'd have to call Rebecca, and then Rebecca would help me communicate, and Jimmy would verify.
From the grave, I'd be like, why did you get a truck? What time do you have to put together a truck? From the grave, I would whisper that, and I'd be like, poor Jen.
Yeah. I think everybody says poor Jen.
I got a question for you guys. Have you ever gotten when you're recording, did you ever get a voice that wasn't there and you're like, what was that?
So.
Me, he does all that, so.
I have experienced EVP numerous times. And
what's EVP?
Electronic voice phenomena. And my entire life has been spent around some form of technology, okay? When I was a kid, I was really interested in building ham radios. Okay, now ham radio stuff I can excuse because you're picking
fuzz
up signals all
yeah.
over the place. Okay, but one time I was playing with it wasn't exactly a speak and spell, but it was one of those types of toys. You know, remember speak and spells and stuff? And I was playing with one of those, and they do the common thing whatever speak and spell says, they're programmed to say certain things. And I was playing with it and it said something. Are you listening to me?
So it picked up something.
And I'm getting goosebumps. I was maybe 9, but I remember it so distinctly. Are you listening to me? And it had nothing to do with anything that was pre-programmed on this thing you push.
B is for barnyard.
Yeah, it was very similar to that.
Moo.
Are you listening?
it was a full sentence. Are you listening? And that was it. And I kept trying to get it to come back. Nothing. Another time I used a you're from Hamden. Mm-hmm. So you're familiar with along Treadwell and what's that?
Putnam.
No, not Putnam. But it runs from Putnam to Treadwell, that street where the firing range is. There's the firing range that's encased in concrete. The wall. You don't remember the wall? It's behind the apartments over there off Treadwell.
Yeah, I'm not sure of the street.
There's an old firing range, and we used to sneak under the grate and go in there, and it was pitch black because there's no light, no electricity. We'd go in there, and I went in once with a walkie-talkie, and it was just, you know, static. And we'd go through, and you'd hear, like, you would pick up weird voices talking. So we did that. And then sometimes, you know, you leave the TV on too late, you wake up at night, and sometimes you'd feel like you'd see things. But the only, like, honest to goodness experience is with that stupid toy. You know, are you listening?
It probably was just programmed from your mom, probably saying that to you over and over again.
No, it was...
I have a story for you, kind of like when my sister was maybe 12 or 13, she used to do a radio show. We both did, but she was doing her own radio show in her bedroom with her friend, and I was in the next bedroom, and all of a sudden I heard them scream and both run down the stairs. So I went down, I said, what happened? They said, we're doing our little radio show. And remember back in the olden days where... You have to keep everything unplugged because you're wasting electricity. So I checked because I was a little detective. They didn't have their stereo or the stereo with the speakers plugged in. Yeah. They were recording on a tape recorder. So they were doing a radio show for themselves.
Yeah.
And I said, what happened? They said, we heard those little music boxes, those little kind of tinkly little music,
how creepy
it is. Yeah, yeah.
I hear and I feel like, I'm about to die.
Yeah.
But every movie I've ever seen.
Where is Freddy Krueger?
Right. Every movie I've ever seen says, I'm about to die.
They're supposed to be pleasant, but they're terrifying. So they heard this little, that little like music box music, but it was Home on the Range. It was playing Home on the Range. And they don't know where it was coming from. So they ran downstairs. You know. So we went back upstairs. They were still, I saw the tape still rolling.
Oh, no.
So I said, let's go back and see if we can hear it.
This is gonna be creepy,
right? So we press play and you could hear the home on that, which she still has it actually on tape.
Oh, that's cool.
And you hear the music and then you hear a voice say, let me out.
Shut up.
Yeah.
I hate it so much.
What I go into these YouTube black holes where people show the videos and stuff, the EVP stuff, and there's this one really good one you've probably seen where they capture an image and it looks like a demon crawling out from the dark, and they capture the voice, and you can hear the voice. It says, "I have the body of a pig." Have you heard that
one?
No. Oh, it's really creepy.
I don't want to hear it.
Yeah, it's like, I have the body of a
pig. I have the body of a pig, but in a different way.
Yeah.
No, I'm petite. Hey,
we love ourselves on this show.
You know what's weird about the EVPs is that we used. When I first started, we used cassette recorders.
Yeah.
And it seemed like that was better, easier to get EVPs on. Maybe because of the magnetic nature of the tape or whatever. But there's a lot of new apps and machines people use now that have pre-programmed noises and words built into the unit, which is supposed to help because usually a little white noise or something helps a voice manifest instead of silence. So I understand that part. But I also don't like the pre-programmed words because they're already in there. You know, so that old abandoned was it nursing home
in
Cheshire? It's back in the woods by Blackie's.
But this is already creepy.
Oh yes.
Okay.
I thought you were talking about Undercliff in Meriden.
No, over here.
Old abandoned nursing home.
Yeah, kids don't go running in there. It's very dangerous. There's holes in the floors.
I'm gonna probably edit out where.
Yeah.
So there's a creepy old abandoned building in Cheshire.
Yeah, right.
There's an old abandoned building.
In Cheshire.
Around here.
Right.
Okay.
There's an old abandoned building somewhere.
In the vicinity
of Connecticut. Yes.
So you've been here. You've been there.
Yes.
Okay.
And a couple of my friends came to visit from New Jersey, and they had one of these machines that had the pre-programmed, you know, voices in the recorder. So we're going through the building. And it said, it's coming out with these really weird words, like, that don't make sense. Like, Bart Simpson. Like, it says Bart Simpson. So we go around the corner, and there's an 8-foot painting of, with a spray paint of Bart Simpson. And then they'll say, and I'm like, well, how does this thing know this, you know?
Yeah.
And then,
that's a really weird coincidence.
Then you hear 1977. And then on another wall, somebody spray painted 1977. We've never been there before, and there's different floors, so... It was really amazing. Like, what's telling us that?
I had a similar circumstance happen again. My YouTube black holes. You know, I go in, and I was at a point where I was falling asleep. So I'm in that like
twilight,
and I hear on the TV, I hear a voice say, "Corey Nash," and I wake up, And I go, what did I just hear that? And I rewind it. And sure enough, the guy is saying my name in the video because he's climbing through a tunnel. I think I've told the story before, but he's climbing through a tunnel at Sleeping Giant, and I had spray painted my name on the wall, and he just happened to look at it and read it.
He was
experiencing it. That's a wicked coincidence right there.
And I was like, whoa.
We were doing like
the TV was talking to me.
In college, and hall dorm room.
Mushrooms?
10 of us, maybe 12 girls, soccer, rugby girls. I know where you guys think this is going, but it's not. Ouija board. We just ordered, everybody ordered pizza. We had a ton of soda, and we just all sat down and started playing with the Ouija board. I don't know where it came from. Whatever, it was just in the end hall lounge. So, you know, we're all playing, we're laughing, ha ha ha, it's moving, and nobody's really paying attention to it. So we were asking it this, you know, silly, ridiculous questions, and it's answering, and somebody asked, like, is somebody in here with us? One of those questions. And we're like, ha ha ha. The power goes out in the building, all the posters rip off the walls.
Holy mackerels.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, that's scary.
Yeah, it was scary. Okay, maybe not all the posters. I think two, but they were kind of next to each other. But still, that was pretty. We all screamed and ran, and nobody went to the end hall lounge for like months. I think we threw out the Ouija board. I don't think we played again.
The Ouija board is one of those things where you could play it a million times and nothing happens, and then one person tries it once and they.
I cannot throw away my Ouija board. I have kept it with me since I was like 13. I have it stored in this house somewhere. I'm terrified to try to throw it away.
You do a radio show. Mm-hmm. I saw recently you had a guest on that makes his own Ouija boards.
Yes.
Out of wood?
Danny Perez. He's like lives artwork. In Connecticut. Yeah, he'll make custom Ouija boards for people. Like you can give him a subject, anything you like, and he'll make it.
Oh, like a Game of Thrones Ouija board.
Yeah. And I think.
Oh, I should have him make some Ouija boards out of the wood that I took from my grandfather's
house. You would need like craft beer Ouija board.
Need a Cheshire Cast Ouija board. I have a creepy Ouija board story if you want.
Sure.
Of course we do.
I just
That's why
mine.
You're here.
Okay.
Was it creepy enough?
This was a case in Middletown, Connecticut, where this woman just moved into an apartment and she was putting her stuff away and she noticed a box up in the closet. And it was a Ouija board. And she was older. She was probably in her 70s. And she was, oh, I remember using this as a little girl. You know, so she was curious, so she put it right on her lap, and it started moving. And it gave her a name, and it said that he was murdered in the apartments.
Oh.
So this was back before Google and all that. So she actually went to the police department.
Microfiche.
And said, does this name actually exist, and did anything ever happen? You know, she's trying to verify her story that this man's telling her. And they found out, and we actually have we have a mugshot of the guy too. We had the pic. We know what he looks like, what his name is, and how he died, and everything. And he was killed. There's a river that runs by these apartments, and it was around winter time, and he got stabbed, I think 70 or 80 times.
And, a lot of stabbing.
That's a really mad stabber,
right?
And he was thrown in
that
the river.
That dude was exhausted.
And
not much left after
that. The poor guy, he didn't even die. He was crawling up the bank of
what
the river.
Was he stabbed with like a paperclip?
Right. So.
I'm going to take this tack and I'm going to kill you.
It's going to take me all day.
My arms were so sore.
So this poor
you just ruin your shirt. You're like, oh.
Basically, we just ruined the story.
I know.
No. So apparently this guy was climbing. This is what the police said. He was crawling up the bank to, you know, try to get help or, you know, and he died. So this woman, so we went to investigate the whole story. And this is a really weird story too, because this is with the Warrens. We had a card table and we were carrying the table. It was nighttime. We're carrying it through the apartment complex and everyone starts coming out. Like, what are these people doing here with flashlights and a table going to the river? And then they're kind of being aggressive towards us. Then we told them the story and then they thought it was all cool. So we had a big crowd around us. And so she starts doing the board she's saying, they're suggesting questions like, why are you still here? And he said, I'm stuck here or whatever. And they said, well, could you forgive the people that did this to you? And he said, yes. And he spelled out, I can't forgive the people that were closing their doors and closing their windows. And I was crying out for help.
Those are the people you're going to forgive.
Yeah. So anyways, I have this whole thing on it. I was video, back then we had videotape. I was video recording the whole session. And it's going to be, as soon as they get it done, they're going to have it as a permanent exhibit at the National Talking Board Museum in Salem.
Ooh.
Soon, hopefully.
Salem. What a creepy place. I've been there a couple of times.
So you've done some TV appearances too. So you were on Sightings?
Yeah, I was never like the focal point of the show. I was on Sightings.
Were you like the guy that just walked by the window?
He held a microphone.
We were
like, hi.
The Sightings episode was called The Lady in White. The segment was called The Lady in White. And
Is that Stepney?
Oh, this one Union? was focused on Union Cemetery and Stepney Cemetery.
Yeah.
And they reenacted the two major sightings that they had there.
Yep.
And a part of the segment was showing the pictures that you get from the cemeteries there.
Right, like, on the old film.
Yeah, and for some reason, at these cemeteries, you get incredible pictures. And of course, you're not allowed to go there now because you get incredible pictures.
Right.
Because it became so popular that you can't even sit on the street at night and the cops will kick you right out.
And Unsolved Mysteries you were on?
Unsolved Mysteries was an exorcism that they actually filmed us.
I want to know about the exorcisms.
Okay. So ask him. That's what he's here for.
Like what? What? Start. Someone calls you and says, I need help?
No. It, I didn't look out for this stuff. Like I didn't seek it out. You know, it just kind of evolved into...
Hold on. Was any of the people that you were exorcising...
You're like a physical therapist now.
What are the people you were performing an or participating or witnessing an exorcism being done to?
Mm-hmm.
Named Reagan?
No.
No. Oh.
No.
Everybody gets it?
But yeah.
Okay.
Just Reagan McNeil exorcist.
That was a long way for a
but
that movie, you know, Exorcist. Oh my gosh, I need to up my meds.
You know, everyone thinks that you know these. You know, there's no head spinning. There's a lot of vomiting.
Is it green?
Like, sometimes.
Yeah.
I guess it depends on if they had pea soup.
Right.
But, and it's like, you know, it's more scary. I mean, of course, you know, anybody could act out. And,
how do you find out? What are they? You're skipping that.
Okay,
whole part.
I'm sorry. It all started from let me go back to the first time we ever did an exorcism was just of a home. And Meriden, and Lorraine Warren told me, she goes, because I was the only one with a video camera back then. So
you were the techie. Yeah.
I was a tech guy with one machine.
He was like, I ain't afraid of no ghosts, and he came with like the backpack.
So she said, Jim
and Ray Parker Jr.
Do you want to record the exorcism tomorrow? And I said, sure. So she goes, but you have to make sure you're in a state of grace. And I said, what's a state of grace? And she goes, you have to go to confession. And have you gone to confession? I was like, not for years.
Are you religious? What if you were like Jewish?
Let him finish. Well, I know where he's going.
Yeah. She just recommended I do that. So I said, what, you know, she's called confession. So I went to the church the next day and I said, forgive me, Father. It's been 5 years since my last confession. He's like, well, why'd you wait so long? I said, well, I have an exorcism to go to tomorrow. And you know how you have this little curtain that's supposed to keep you anonymous? He pulled the curtain away and pulled me out of the room and sat me in a chair and said, okay, tell me all about this.
Yeah.
They're very interested in this stuff. So that was just the exorcism of a home.
It's also extremely dangerous.
But the ones I'm normally talking about are actual people. And what happened was we were investigating one case in Massachusetts where she's only 19 years old. She moved in with her boyfriend and they rented a house. And they started hearing scratches, voices, things moving. And they hear scratches, but then they look at and they were young kids. They didn't have a lot of money. I don't think they do this to their own house for no reason, but there'd be like three claw marks on the wall in the kitchen. Then it would be in the hallway leading up to the bedroom.
Jesus.
And then the next day it would be like higher up. And so they said, you know, before this thing gets up to our room, that's what it was looking like.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, we got their whole story and, I said, you know, this all of a sudden started. Did you have anything happened to you when you were a kid or did it just start in this house? She goes, well, when I was 13, I had these weird things happen to me where like she'd be laying in bed and her arm would go into the air and something would start twisting it back and forth, violent enough to break bones in her hand and wrist. And it happened over and over again. And her parents would record this, of course, to bring to a doctor and say, what is this? You know?
Right, right.
So she got treated for different epilepsy. And
Isn't there a condition like called phantom hand or something to that effect where it's an actual
probably
issue with the brain where your brain controls a limb differently, and that limb will actually cause you harm. I think that's what it's called, phantom hand.
That's a scary story right there.
Yeah, it's a real
phantom hand.
It's
phantom,
a real brain issue.
Phantom
where
pains are once you've had
no
a thing removed, you still feel it.
No, this is where you're. I'll let him tell a story and I'll look it up.
Yeah, we got to research that. I want to know about that. So, it wasn't just that. She'd get it appears on the video that something's holding her wrist and she's getting smacked back and forth around the room, you know.
She wasn't just having a seizure. There was something actively engaging.
Yeah, she did
her.
Get treated for stuff and give medication and went away after about
a year.
Her
parents sought help, obviously.
Yeah, and it's not just that. It's just like a lot of things happened to her, all odd things. And they videotaped it to show the doctors, like, what is this? And then they just treated her for a bunch of stuff because they couldn't figure it out. I'm not saying she was possessed, but we didn't know about this until later in the investigation. So, like, you know, maybe there's something here. So the priest that we work with said he'd be willing to give her an exorcism. And she goes, I don't think I'm possessed or anything, but, you know, give it a shot. You know, maybe it'll help.
Hmm.
So we went up there and she was, I really don't think, you know, nothing's going on. So
she didn't feel it.
No. So she was sitting in the chair and the priest starts doing his prayers and everything. He's doing quiet prayers. And all of a sudden her eyes just turn white, you know, her eyes roll back over her head. Like, oh boy, like that was the first time we ever experienced anything like this. So she starts screaming.
Now you're doing this with a priest.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We had a priest, an assistant, and we had three people from our group. So she starts going, you know, getting up, going towards the priest. So we have restraints, which, you know, nowadays, I don't know if we'd do that anymore. But we had restraints.
Sounds like that's a good thing you had them.
Yeah, but it's to protect her. Us and to protect her and to protect the priest, because they go after the priest a lot. So anyways, she acted up a lot for like an hour or so. And after it was all over, she's like, I can't believe that I didn't think anything. You know, I didn't think anything would happen.
So do you get scared?
I'll tell you when I got scared.
Okay.
So we videotaped this exorcism, and we had a website back then. It was like real, you know, it wasn't fancy. It was way back in the 90s. But ABC, producer from ABC was scouring the internet trying to find stories for a show or whatever. So they contacted us and they said, you know, can we do a segment on that exorcism? So everyone agreed.
Even the girl?
Yeah.
Ooh.
And they interviewed her and everything, and you know, everything was fine afterwards. So, but after that exorcism, it was on ABC. Back then it was like ABC, NBC, CBS. That was basically it. So everyone was watching.
They were ecstatic.
So we got so many emails from people all over the country saying, you know, this is happening to my daughter or whatever, and we can't find any help here. So there was seven people in our group. We each had like 20 cases each to see, you know, who's really legit, who really needs help, who, you know, we got to figure all this out ourselves. It's brand new. We didn't, you know, we're trying to.
And you were the only game in town. Who else is doing something like that?
Right. It wasn't many people.
And not many people were being national television.
Right. So I was, you saying what scared me more than I've been bitten and threatened, you know, they said they're gonna get you, you know, we're not gonna get you today, it might not be tomorrow, but you're gonna get it, you know, basically. And they all say the same thing too. That's the scary part. But one particular lady, she's from Virginia, and she was a woman in our group's case, so I didn't know any details. We didn't know any details about her except she's flying in from Virginia. Somebody's picking her up, and we were setting up the altar for the exorcism. We get there's a special chair we have. We set it up for the priest, so it's all ready to go. So the only thing we knew, like I said, she's from Virginia. That's all we knew. So a police officer was in our group, and me and him got there early, and we're waiting for the woman to come. And he says, oh, Jim, he goes, you know, you're in a church, you feel like you're, you know, holy for the hour or whatever. So he said, Jim, I feel bad. You know, I got to an argument with my mother on the phone last night, and I feel really bad. I'm going to apologize. As soon as I get back home, I got to call her up and apologize. So that was just a conversation we were having, you know, when nobody's in the church. So then the woman, you know, sits in the chair, and the priest is doing his prayers and stuff. And she's the one, she's literally 95 pounds. And you know, the canvas restraints with the buckles and everything.
Mm-hmm.
She was strapped in with her ankles and wrists, and she just got up like it was like like it was, you know, like spaghetti,
like Velcro.
It. Like she just got up like it was nothing and went after the priest. We had to hold her back and she bit my arm. But this same woman, and then there's also, you know, people say people can get great strength from that word when you like lift a car off your kid when you get that rush of
adrenaline.
Adrenaline. And it's
or
nice.
PCP,
one or the other. Yeah. And I always wondered about that because I said, you know, people can do amazing things like that. But we have a psychologist in our group that explained it nicely. She goes, yes, if your child is trapped underneath a car.
Moms have been known to lift cars.
You can get that car. But if somebody's just sitting there and a priest is saying prayers over you, you're not going to get that rush of adrenaline to break out of canvas and buckles. You know. So anyway, that was pretty scary. But now suppose she's just sitting there nice and quiet. She looks over to the cop and says, and the way that you talked to your mother last night, that was disgusting. And then just put her face forward, looked at the priest again. That scared me more than anything, knowing that she had knowledge of
stuff
she doesn't know. We have a girl in Germany right now that's speaking different languages that we're working with.
Well, of course she's speaking. She's in Germany. Of course she's speaking a different language.
More than German. Yeah, we were talking about
speaking in tongues.
We just did a circle back to Germany because you were talking about Germany before, and I was saying how excited I was when I was a kid when you learn about different countries. You're like Hamburg and Frankfurt are in Germany.
He showed me a trailer earlier and it was dubbed in
German. You stepped on his joke.
You showed me a trailer earlier and it was dubbed in German. That's weird. That's a lot of Germany in one episode.
Well, this will be.
I was enjoying his Hamburg Frankfurt
Hamburg and Frankfurt
joke.
Story.
You didn't.
I was just.
What's wrong with you?
Nothing.
I get excited over that stuff.
Yeah, I would. I'm excited over Hamburgs.
She speaks in tongues, huh?
And Frankfurts, hers. Well, Frankfurter,
so
hers.
In essence, she has spirits in her that all speak different languages.
Well, we're still working with her, but she had a previous.
So you're back in the game now.
Yeah, but we're filming part two for a documentary.
Hostage to the Devil.
Yeah, it's gonna be like kind of a sequel to that, tentatively called The Devil Within.
Do you need music for it? I'll get you.
Yeah. Put some creepy music right there. So this woman.
No,
here,
I got a band. I'll write some. Oh, okay. You know, I'll write some music for the film.
They're gonna insert creepy music here. So
I could do that too. But
this woman here, she had a previous exorcism about 3 or 4 years ago in Austria. They can't do exorcisms in Germany anymore because of the Annalise Michel story. If you know about that, the movie Emily Rose is based on her story.
Uh huh.
But they don't. They won't do exorcisms in Germany anymore because this girl died during the exorcism, and you know they sued. So she went to Austria for one, and we have a letter from the bishop from Austria that said during the exorcism, and she claims not to know these other languages, but she was they test you in different languages and ask you questions to see if you can answer them. During the exorcism, it was like a pop quiz. So she answered fluently back and forth with in Aramaic, in Indian, different languages. And the other scary part is anybody could learn a language. But she said, this is the nicest girl ever, normally. And she said, I feel really bad because I got up. They told me later that I got up and was mocking there's a bishop that was witnessing the whole thing. He wasn't part of it. He was witnessing it. And she got up and started mocking him because she said, when you had polio when you were a little boy, you walked like this. And nobody else knew that in the thing. So we have this whole letter. So we're working with her right now, and we're probably going to get her here.
That'd make for an interesting interview.
I'm sick that day.
You don't want to do that?
Emily will do it.
Well, maybe we do it somewhere else. Like not in the house. So So you want a creepy story?
Yeah.
From Sleeping Giant State Park? So Sleeping Giant State Park, when I was in college, I was at Quinnipiac for a couple semesters. We used to hike up that mountain at night. One night
Why not?
Yeah. Well, we would hike up there to, smoke pot. Because, it wasn't as accepted as it is now.
Really? In the 60s it wasn't?
Yeah, in the 60s. So we would hike up the Blue Trail, which is one of the cliffs. And one night we're up there, and I heard a kid. Like, I heard a little boy laughing and, giggling and you know, making little kid noises like they would.
It's probably a little fox playing with each other.
Well, years later, I'm up sleeping giant with my wife. We're hiking. There's a plaque, like a monument at the edge of the cliff where a little boy fell. Mm. And that's where we were 20 years ago. Maybe it was a fox. Maybe.
Fox do sound like laughing children.
Maybe it was. But there was a kid who apparently fell off the top of that.
See, I think when you're open to experiences like that or putting those strings of thoughts together.
You mean stoned?
Yes. No, I mean like superstitious in a way. Like you're open to it. You dig it. You see it when somebody else wouldn't because you're like, yeah, that could happen.
You know what?
I wouldn't.
Why are little kids the creepiest thing? Like a little kid's laugh?
It depends on the surrounding situation.
I did a whole show on creepy things kids say to their parents. You ever go on that run?
Listen,
on YouTube?
Yes. I have kids. They say some creepy stuff.
All of my kids have said creepy things at some point.
My son
other.
Just the other day. You know what'll get you, Mom? What? What'll get me? Time. Time will get you.
What, Emily?
What?
Oh, you want to know what you said? I'm not telling you.
Like he remembers. Parents don't remember. My son just said it last week. That's why I remember it. Time. Time will get you, Corey.
That's what you're.
That's what he said. You know what'll get you? Time.
Where did they get that?
Why did your kid call you Corey? That's weird.
That is weird.
It's this thing now.
I remember one kid said, you know, the father said, good night, whoever. And he said, goodbye, dad. And he goes, no, we don't say goodbye. We say good night. And the little kid said, no, but this time it's goodbye. You know what? Then one kid said to the father, I want to cut your head off so I can carry it around all the time because I miss you when I'm at school. Like just little kids are creepy.
They are.
They're so separated from like social norms.
Well, one of my kids, I'm not going to say which one, said, I wish I could take a piece of you with me all the time.
which piece?
I don't know. I was like, okay, good night.
You can have a toe. You can have a toe. That's it. As far as I'll go. Talk about the giving tree.
One of my kids used to wake up in the middle of the night and walk into my bedroom and stand next to my bed.
Isn't that the scariest thing?
And
like,
stare at me until I woke up.
I'd rather see a monster than a little kid looking at you while you're sleeping.
Yeah. And I would wake up and I go,
well, you know what? That's kind of nice. They're letting you sleep. Because mine would have been like, Mom, Mom, Mom.
One of my children had violent night terrors. You both have kids. Have you experienced night terrors?
Nope.
It's the worst thing ever. My kid would have them. He'd wake up screaming.
Was he taking melatonin at the time?
No.
Okay.
He'd wake up screaming in the middle of the night, and he would be telling me that somebody was trying to get him, or they're right there. He'd be wide awake, or so it would seem. And I remember in one of my YouTube black holes reading or learning about these night terrors, and they'd say you'd have to talk them through it to get them to calm down and not, you know, not try to shake them or wake them up. So I would have to sit with him and I'd hold him and I'd say, you're in your room. I'm with you. You know, everything's good. You're safe. And you talk them out like, tell that person, tell whatever you see to go away. And
being a kid's tough, man. Not
and I would talk, them through until he would fall back to sleep. It was happening like, and it got real bad when he'd get fevers. If he would get sick, those were the worst ones. And these are screams of torment and torture, not just like, Mom, I don't feel good. These were like, I'm being tortured and tormented by something.
Ouch.
This is the worst.
Jimmy, if someone was interested in going to a haunted place, where would you suggest they go?
Well, you know what? They have a lot of like...
My house.
They have a lot of touristy kind of places now where they'll have a house that's has a history of being haunted, and they'll actually do tours, like, you know, like $50 a night or whatever, and you can get to do overnights. There's a ton of them going on. But like, just for local, like, you know, when I first started, I was so interested, but I didn't know where to go. And, you know, it took me years to figure out where Union Cemetery was just so I could take some pictures. And the first time I went there, I thought a ghost was going to come out. I thought that's what happens. Because it was so haunted, I figured a ghost's going to come out and I'll take its picture. But I just, you know, wasted hours there and nothing happened. So I took a roll of film, and when I got developed, I got some weird stuff on the film. So I kept going back and back and back.
This is the one where they don't let anybody go anymore.
Right, right.
They don't let anybody go anywhere. I mean, Dudleytown, can't go there.
Dudleytown was
Stepney, can't go there.
Incredible.
Union,
Dudley,
can't go
Dudleytown. But Stepney, Stepney, they'll tell you, you know, hey, you shouldn't be here, but you probably won't get a ticket or anything. Stepney,
what if you set up like a spirits walk or something?
Yeah.
Like get a permit.
Like he does in Milford?
That's an event Cindy Wolf Boynton has in Milford. She has a ghost walk, I think, probably every week up till Halloween.
Don't you do that too?
I went with them once.
Okay.
We just had a spirits alive.
Different thing.
So that's what I meant.
Yeah.
Set up something like that. But it sounds like it's already done. Yeah, I'm so into Halloween.
But all the good places that are public, like in Connecticut, like you said, Dudleytown, Stepney, Union.
Are those cemeteries?
Dudleytown.
They won't let you there.
Yeah. Dudleytown is a settlement. It's an actual little town.
Okay.
It's way in the woods, and everybody that moved in there got sick.
Why is it way in the woods?
Because it's not a town anymore, and they let it grow.
There's only foundations left in the ground.
If you go,
the whole town died off from a sickness.
Yes.
Ooh. So it's haunted, and people go and
tragedy causes the ghost syndrome.
Thing. I've never experienced anything there, and we would go there all the time in the 90s.
But people have, I'm sure. Otherwise, it wouldn't be
other
such
people
a big thing.
Have it. It's just weird because you are walking through the woods, and then there's a whole bunch of foundations and stuff, and it's like, whoa, this is weird. And it's in the middle of the woods. Yeah. So, it's weird.
100%
you know what's weird? It's like almost anybody I talk to, you know, when you go down the main trail to get to Dudleytown?
Yep.
There's a tree that's across the trail.
Yep.
And as soon as you go, like, you hear, like, crickets, birds, and everything, and as soon as you go past a certain point, just everything stops. The trees are dead. Everything stops, all the animal sounds and everything.
Yeah.
That's what's creepy about it. And one time I was there.
It's like a natural phenomenon's going on over there or something.
I had the exact opposite experience where I went there and I saw a raccoon and I heard noises and there was mosquitoes and I'm like, yeah,
there's mosquitoes here. It's not haunted.
Yeah, it's not haunted.
Why would a mosquito want to hang around a haunted place?
Yeah, no.
They could be anywhere. Why there?
And then again, if somebody told you, like, you know, you have it planted in your head already that this place is haunted. So anything that happens out of the ordinary, oh my God, it's because it's haunted.
Well, correct.
If it was just woods, you wouldn't think anything of it.
Yes.
The power of suggestion and your susceptibility to that's really, I'm sure, plays a big part into your experience of the creepiness, of the haunted, of the, because you have to be part of it. You know what I mean? Like you can't be shut off to it. You have to be ready to experience it.
That's why especially when you investigate a house, I don't like knowing the story beforehand so much before you walk through somebody's house, because, you know, somebody will say, oh my God, all the activities in the, you know, my daughter's bedroom, and it's crazy in there and it feels so heavy and all this, and it can get cold spots and everything.
Right.
So then everybody that goes in there says, oh yeah, I feel it. Like, because you already have it in
suggestion.
Your head that something's going to happen in there.
Well, my mother-in-law's house, the previous owner or the owner before the previous owner, one of the owners hung himself in the garage. And evidently one of the cats she either currently has or has had in the past sits and stares at a certain spot in the house.
Cats are creepy
like they see this person.
They're like conduits.
Yeah. Yeah, animals.
Not dogs. Dogs are always so goofy.
You see a cat stop and look at something that's not there and you're like, what are they looking at?
They are looking at something.
They're seeing something.
What does Mr. Haunted do for Halloween?
Hand out candy to trick-or-treaters.
Do you dress up? Do you decorate your house?
The kids do. They're doing it this year. It's the first year they're gonna stay home, and they just want to give candy out.
So Mr. Haunted is a married guy,
yeah,
with kids,
right?
You're just a dad and a husband
on a haunted hiatus. That's really.
But I go to work at 4 a.m. in the morning, and some people, they don't understand that, like, what
do you do for work?
We unload trucks early in the morning.
See?
So, yeah, then
it's just a normal guy.
It's a normal guy that did an exorcism the night before and nobody knows. No one's going back to work. Going to work.
That's
my
better
because
that people would be like, you need like a holy water shower.
No, what's funny is you're the weirdo all year and then come around, you know, come Halloween time, it's all of a sudden everybody wants to hear your stories.
Yeah,
and
it's
talk
like
to
Santa
you.
Claus. You got
well,
one night.
Listen,
to
you
shine.
Can come in on the show in July if you want. That's fine. We can have you be a recurring guest. I don't care.
But we can talk about anything.
Yeah, you know, it just made it for an interesting Halloween episode.
I didn't mean you guys. I meant everybody at work.
Well, hey, you know, I took offense.
Did
sorry.
You? I didn't.
No.
I don't know what he's talking about.
I know you're not.
Where am I?
Who are you? Why am I here?
What month is it?
This part of the, what was that place called?
Oh, the McKenna.
Is this part of the McKenna mansion?
McCamey Manor.
McCamey Manor.
Everybody who's listening to this episode, if you want to be totally creeped out, it's ridiculous, look up McCamey Manor. Only after you, of course, look up our guest.
If you really want to be creeped out, look up my picture and Jimmy's picture online.
Yep. Oh, yeah, we'll take a pic.
And if you want, before it disappears off Netflix, Hostage to the Devil is still on Netflix.
Ooh.
Well,
I think.
We're going
to. Ooh, that's so creepy. I don't know if I can.
I guess
I
that's
want
what
to.
Emily's going to watch tonight.
I want to, but I don't know if I can. Is it exorcisms?
It's not that scary. It's the story of Malachi Martin, who was he was a Vatican priest who was an advisor to two popes. He had multiple degrees in ancient languages. He was an amazing guy. And you could have done five different documentaries about the different things he did. He was an archaeologist in Egypt. Mm. He just did. So anyways, he came to America and kind of did like an underground exorcism because it was so hard for people in the Catholic Church to get exorcisms. You had to go through all these processes and take years. And if somebody's really suffering, he was trying to help people get things moving along. So he was a very controversial figure. And the documentary focuses more on his exorcisms that we did. So,
Jimmy, I am jazzed that you came in.
Thank you.
And I'm very pleased to have met you. I know that you're a fan. I'm
a top fan.
Apparently, that's what the thing says. You got a badge now.
Yay.
You know, so I would love to have you back in again. We could talk more. This stuff fascinates me to no end.
And happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
Whoa. I can't do a good voice. A good
do you,
creepy.
Do you have some closing words?
I do. Cheshire News.
You have something to say about Cheshire?
I do. All right.
Okay.
So because I was out for like the last 2 months, I was trying to get a guest on and it never worked out. I just couldn't fit him in, but I have to make a quick announcement and it's the Cheshire Food Drive.
46th annual?
46th annual Cheshire Food Drive. And you can send stuff to school with your kids, any type of food donation. I'm sure something non-perishable. Through October 21st through November 1st. And they do this once a year. It's www.cheshirefooddrive.org. They also collect food townwide. And this one food drive does a large portion of the food for the food pantry for the year.
Fantastic.
So send stuff in with your kids or stop by. I believe they're doing it on the green.
Yeah. We'll have to post something on the Facebook page.
Yeah. So Cheshire Food Drive, look for it. And Lights of Hope is coming up. So we
Lights of Hope coming up November 9th. Mm-hmm. If you haven't gotten your
luminaries
from your neighborhood captain, then you need to go to Heinz Hardware and get your luminaries there.
And
$12 a bag.
Register
or $12
to vote. Thing.
Got to register till the 29th.
Register
they have,
to vote.
And then vote on November 5th, not the 7th.
Or the 6th.
Dave Lieber. Oh, he's going to be mad that I did that.
Cut it out.
No.
Cut it out, Corey.
He's my friend.
Just,
I'm teasing
just cut
him.
It out. Go ahead.
Cut it out. And last but not least, pick up Jimmy's book, Phantom Messages.
I can't wait to read that.
You get it on Amazon.
I'm going
to
hear stuff after I read it.
Is it audiobook too?
Yes.
I wonder if
you'll really hear stuff.
Somebody actually read it.
I wonder if in the audiobook they pick up any EVP.
The whole audiobook is the EVP.
It is.
Did I say that right?
Yeah.
EVP.
You did. Jimmy, again, thank you for coming.
Thanks, fellas.
It was a pleasure to meet you.
I'm not a fellas.
She's not a fella.
Thank you.
All right, Corey, outro to you. Go.
Outro to me?
Yeah.
One, two, three, bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Let's get out of here! Like now!
Okay, so I'll see you later, huh? I'll give you a call.
Okay, see you later, pal.
Amigos, time to depart.